All right. Hello and welcome everyone to panel number 3, Material and Labor in Performance for Networks 2020, which is Networks Mapping Labor in Theater and Performance. So in this panel, we have Deepsikha Chatterjee, who is a fellow student of mine at the Theater and Performance PhD program of the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. I am Mayurakshi Sen, a fourth year PhD student at the same program. And before I let Deepsikha take it away from here, I just want to plug in the how-to, the details for the live Q&A session that will follow our speakers' presentations. So you, our live stream viewers, can send in your questions and participate. So there are 3 ways of doing so. Number 1, if you are watching this live stream on Facebook, which will be our Facebook page, the PhD program in theater at the Graduate Center CUNY, you can just simply comment your questions underneath the live streaming video. Number 2, if you are watching it on howlround.com, and if you're a Twitter user, you can tweet your questions at HowlRound, that is the Twitter handle for HowlRound, at HowlRound, and use the hashtag networks2020. Number 3, if you are an Instagram user, you can private message us your questions at our official Insta account, which is at PhD Theater Grad Center CUNY. Remember, all the theaters end with T-R-E and not T-E-R. So Deepsikha, take it away from here. And I will be muting myself.
Thank you, Mayu. We have Christine Snyder, who is a fourth year student in the CUNY graduate program. I am Deepsikha. I'm a second year student in the CUNY graduate program, and I am moderating the panel. And this is my 7th Zoom session today, so excuse me if I'm a little frazzled. Also, I have invisible labor of having 2 kids at home, so they might pop up and make this a little bit more interesting. And we have Jessa Laframboise, who's a graduate student at Carleton College in Canada. And we will be talking about invisible and visible labor. Jessa, go ahead and start.
Thank you so much. So I'll just get right into it. Performance art is not a singular art form. It is a genre of art history that can be divided into various categories. These categories are established by strategies that artists use to disseminate their concepts and assert their bodies. Types of performances that I have explored in my own research include temporary live performance, photo-documented performance, and material trace performance. Material trace performance being the subject of today's discussion. The material trace performance that I'll be analyzing here is called Butterfly Kisses by Janine and Tony. Butterfly Kisses is a series of performative drawings made from CoverGirl Thick Lash Mascara. The resulting image was created after the artist applied mascara to her eyelashes and transferred pigment to paper through the act of butterfly kissing. Understanding the way that Antoni activated her body during the creation of Butterfly Kisses reiterates that while we are viewing a stagnant object, Butterfly Kisses is not solely about what the work looks like. The imagery in Butterfly Kisses signals Antoni's actions during an experience that she cultivated for herself. As a result, the demands of conducting an analysis on a material trace performance like Butterfly Kisses means that visualizing and understanding the performance that took place is just as important as understanding the stagnant image or object that is on view. As art historian Amelia Jones explains, this hybrid art form requires hybrid modes of analysis. To advance Butterfly Kisses as a type of performance and grounding my approach in feminist dialogue and theory, much like Antoni did in her own studio practice, I wish to explore the labor in this work. The importance of how the work was made in relation to labor is ultimately problematized because Antoni does not strive to obviously depict herself in the process of cosmetic adornment. So long as we recognize that each eyelash stroke represents a moment in time, And when accumulated in butterfly kisses, they represent the duration of Antoni's performance, then labor should present itself. There are several questions that need not be evaded when openly interpreting material trace performance. And of course, the one I will be exploring in this presentation is how does labor exist in this particular material trace performance, and how do audiences understand labor in a work like Butterfly Kisses? To broach this question in relation to this work, what needs to be analyzed is cosmetics and their role. I suggest that the use of cosmetics is what leads to the creation of Butterfly Kisses. Through the participation of everyday makeup rituals, Antoni opts to reveal the resulting material impact that cosmetics, particularly mascara, can produce. The performance of adornment is the labor that occurred, but the use of cosmetics is what embodies labor for the audience. And while all viewers can engage with butterfly kisses, those who experience cosmetic adornment in some way, whether through personal experience or by association, are likely to have an easier time interpreting the labor in this material trace performance. While butterfly kisses represents the artist's process and subsequent labor, the fact that viewers can only assume how the creation of this work unfolds is ultimately fundamental. In Butterfly Kisses, we witness the artist asserting her presence through the traces of herself that she leaves behind. These visceral traces stand as markers for the artist's touch, which in turn symbolize the artist's presence in performance. This creates an unorthodox there-ness that exists only once the artist is removed from the viewing experience, yet forever engaged in the work through its materiality. While we may not witness Antoni's body and the gestures she engaged in during this prolonged performance that created Butterfly Kisses, we can interpret labor. The repetition of form within this material trace performance stands not only as a record for the artist herself, but as a record for her actions. Butterfly Kisses tracks the movements of the artist's body without the body being present. The signs of having been made correspond to a body having been in motion. Because Antoni's adornment lacks clarity, we must infer a hidden process, a task which demands thoughtful involvement. This results in the performance being both about what the artist did and what happens in the minds and subsequently the memories of the audience as they recognize and relate to the work. At the heart of Butterfly Kisses, like in much of Antoni's work, is the artist's pursuit to imagine how her audience will understand her experience and experience it for themselves. Each spectator who receives Butterfly Kisses will see the work differently and interpret labor differently. What follows is my understanding of her actions and her labor. So here is an image of Butterfly Kisses from Janine Antoni's website. The frequency at which the lines are inscribed across the paper vary and signal a trajectory of motion. Each of these drawings are not overly large on their own, but their size does highlight her need to move around paper. She would not have been able to remain stagnant during its creation. Not only would she have had to move her head as she winked across the paper, but her body would have to be activated as well, so to ensure that her eyelash traces reached the far corners of these performative drawings. Sometimes jagged and sometimes seamless, each trace is connected to the trace of another. Some lines are thicker than others, and some are misshapen lines of heavy black mascara. These dark spots throughout the work are likely the result of Antoni's heavy application of makeup. While she could control how much mascara she was putting on and where and when she fluttered her eyelashes across the paper, the way the pigment would disperse onto the surface of Butterfly Kisses appears more difficult to regulate. This was further perpetuated by the physical limitations of butterfly kissing. Every time Antoni made a mark on the paper, her eyes would have been closed. This, along with her close proximity to the paper, meant that Butterfly Kisses was largely developed through an aleatoric approach to art making. When constructing Butterfly Kisses, Antoni would have likely visualized the entire composition. However, the individual strokes which make up the composition were more dependent on chance. So Butterfly Kisses is ultimately the result of a tedious process. But the meticulous labor that went into creating Butterfly Kisses was complicated by the physical demands of this material trace performance. Antoni took part in the performance aspect of the series in intervals. 3 times a day, she applied cosmetics and proceeded to butterfly kiss paper 20 times per sitting, totaling 60 winks a day. This project proved to be physically demanding, and the artist felt that this was the most she could do at a time. In structuring Butterfly Kisses in this way, Antoni's process is thus not represented throughout the progression of a single adornment ritual from unadorned to fully adorned, but instead, time extends over several routines that she performed day to day. When spectators recreate the development of butterfly kisses in their minds, repetitive line work is not only visually overwhelming, but signals the artist's overwhelming labor. And this is achieved when they not only observe the visual qualities of the series, but also understand the logistics of the artist's movement when creating this material trace performance, reading Antoni's traces as visual cues of an action. This awareness of Antoni's performance during the creation of Butterfly Kisses can also be taken a step further. To truly understand her labor, spectators should try to feel her traces. The artist acknowledges the importance of this viewer engagement when she explains, quote, "I want the viewer to feel it in their body, to register their own eye blinking, and then imagine how many times it would take to reach 2,124. I also want them to feel the accumulation that that number provides. Those who have experience of putting on mascara can also bring that ritual to the work." So to truly feel her trace, one must perform it. There is an urge to follow along with Antoni's motions, blinking with butterfly kisses, imagining that you are adding to the accumulation of the eyelash strokes in these performative drawings. Of course, blinking repetitively is not truly what she did. There was more to this. So, developing off that, I decided to actually do it for myself. I applied mascara and I butterfly kissed a piece of paper, 20 winks per sitting, 3 times throughout the day. While Antoni did this for many months, I did this for 1 day. Here are the results of my butterfly kissing. Here are my traces left by CoverGirl Thick Lash Mascara, an accumulation of 60 winks. I barely filled half of this 8x11-inch piece of paper. Antoni's butterfly kisses were 32x32 inches, and she created multiple iterations all through the same performance and adornment process. Through this, I have literally felt Antoni's movements, now more than ever recognizing the artist's labor during this stage of her performance. But it's also made me more aware of her labor on different levels. It's irrefutable that the application of cosmetics maintains distinct levels of progression. Yet there's no visible transition that is present in the composition of Butterfly Kisses. Audiences do not gaze upon the artist as she applies mascara. All we really know is that every trace left by Antoni's eyelashes is the artist returning to the medium's surface to perform the same gestures. Thus, the only labor that's been present in Antoni's work is that of butterfly kissing. But so much happened prior to the moment that the artist embeds into the visual field. Prior to my re-performance of Butterfly Kisses, I never really considered the adornment element, the moments where Antoni applied mascara repeatedly as a laborious component. We can see the demands of butterfly kissing, but the application process is what entails the unseen labor. From my experiences, I can infer that Antoni applies makeup almost daily for a set number of days. And while eyelashes are coated in fresh mascara, she brushes them across the surface. Every time, without change, Antoni would have done the same action during the same phase of adornment, right after she is adorned. The more mascara the artist applied to her eyelashes, and the quicker the turnover between application and action, the more pigment would transfer. But mascara as a medium is complicated because it dries quickly. from the time she applied the wet mascara to her eyelashes to the moment she transferred pigment to paper, she would have been limited to the amount of times she could butterfly kiss the paper before having to apply more mascara. In my experience, I was able to transfer pigment from my lashes to paper approximately 2 times before having to return to the adornment phase and repeat the process all over again. Because of this material limitation, Antoni would not have been able to veer from her particular arrangement of actions, wait too long, and the mascara would become dry, resulting in no traces being left behind. Start too early, and not enough pigment would transfer. Now, in participating in the labor of this private performance, it's made me wonder, why did Antoni endure the process for so long, for so many months? What does her labor mean? To explore this question, I think it may be useful to perform Antoni's gestures in a manner that does not simply reenact the artist's movements, but responds to them with one's own. We should explore how our movements, participation, and engagement with this material trace performance lends to a grand narrative of cosmetics, adornment, and how our traces would exist in relation to Antoni's. Following this notion, visually speaking, butterfly kisses to me seems to recall the material remnants of the act of removing makeup, all the same as it represents the application. In the case of butterfly kisses, Antoni accelerates this process though. People who adorn themselves in cosmetics tend to stay this way for extended periods of time. Antoni not only rubs the makeup away from her eyelashes instantly, but no one sees her adorned. In butterfly kisses, cosmetics don't seem to serve a purpose of vanity. It's not a tool Antoni uses to enhance her appearance or boost her own self-confidence. So Antoni then sheds light on what cosmetics look like when they're no longer on one's body, when she accumulates her material traces into a series of images. This leads me to assume that Antoni's material trace performance is more concerned with the act and the implication of the adornment. So removing mascara in a practical, non-performative sense mimics an adapted version of Antoni's butterfly kissing. Following this, I myself have created an innumerable amount of butterfly kisses like compositions on makeup removal wipes. Spread across the surface of these wipes are the traces of my own eyelashes. Now, I do not suggest in any way that my material product of the daily makeup removal routine is identical to Antoni's intentional or conceptual material trace performance, but analyzing butterfly kisses has led me to observe my own cosmetic traces that I leave behind. What butterfly kisses look like and what the traces mean have translated to my own personal experience with this process. I see my own actions in butterfly kisses. I see my own markings in butterfly kisses. I experience similar subject matter to Antoni's performative drawings on a regular basis. But I come into contact with these markings through a single makeup wipe, which stands to represent a single adornment routine that is washed away or disposed of almost immediately. Butterfly kisses in this sense resembles the accumulation of makeup wipes and over the course of several months. In the sense, Antoni constructs a powerful dialogue about Western beauty standards and consumers' culture, and in effect, the labor involved. Seeing the gestural strokes of her eyelashes all at once and at this overwhelming frequency for extended periods of time forces me to confront my own position within a dialogue of consumerism, beauty standards, and the labor of my own adornment. Facing a single makeup wipe was never enough to indicate the extent of my own labor. If I were to save these makeup wipes and the traces of mascara that I leave behind, I imagine that I would be faced with an emotional experience parallel to that of Antoni's material trace performance. And so Antoni's labor is enlivened with every spectator who engages with butterfly kisses. Accordingly, the artist's absence and presence ensures that spectators, like me, are looking beyond the physicality of the work and instead begin visualizing the artist's experience, and in turn, their own. The artist's labor is wound up in the materiality of butterfly kisses. Inscribed into its visual field, audiences can work to interpret the artist's movements, actions, and process. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessa. That was so great. Christine, take it over.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for that paper. Hello, my name is Christine Snyder, and I'm a PhD student at the CUNY Graduate Center. My dissertation work will focus on the Civil War musical and the weight of document, the archive, and place, both setting and production location, on the musical's creation, audience reception, and larger questions of US historiography. However, I have a personal interest in off-stage labor practices, specifically in the commercial theater, and particularly on Broadway. When I first arrived in New York City in 1997, my first paying job was as a Broadway usher. For the past 23 years, I have worked in Broadway front of houses for both for-profit and not-for-profit theater companies, as well as backstage for 10 years as a door person. The original form of this paper had been along the lines of a lecture performance. I plan to bring in a dance belt and some pit pads, which are wardrobe essentials for maintaining clean lines and sweat-free costumes, and wash them for the audience while I talked about the sometimes forgotten and unaesthetic work of offstage laborers, including wardrobe, hair, and makeup departments. I also plan to obtain some Vauban or Smellies vomit absorbency powder to pass around as a visceral way of accessing the offstage labor of the front of house staff, including the porters and cleaning persons, ushers, and house managers. The tone was meant to be light and playful, but to also serve as a reminder that offstage labor is often not only not beautiful, but monotonous, gross, hard, and forgotten. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, the olfactory capabilities of Zoom are nil, so the Vauban was out. So too, the physical labor, the embodied in the roomness of washing clothes, is lost in this online format. So I've dispensed with the lecture performance format, but not the more serious points I wanted to make. First, I would like to establish the object of study. Who are the offstage laborers I want to call attention to? They are anyone who lacks what would be considered an artistic or aesthetic impact on the actual performance through agency and choice. This eliminates actors, directors, musicians, dancers, choreographers, set, costume and lighting designers, and producers from my conversation. Instead, I would interrogate the labor of the box office staff, soundboard operators and microphone technicians, ushers and ticket takers, carpenters and set builders, infrared hearing and translation system providers, lighting operators and technicians, press agents, house managers, security guards and canine handlers, company managers, props, makeup and wigs, door persons, engineers, porters and cleaning persons, dressers and wardrobe supervisors, child actor guardians, merchandise, automation, and stage managers. That is a long list, and we only have a short time, so I will do my best to honor these diverse labors as I can. I should also say that I believe that the theatrical arts can and even should make labor beautiful on stage. I would never argue that artists shouldn't use labor as a means of theatrical expression, illuminating the multiple meanings of work for an audience. Papers delivered today have made the case for the aesthetics of labor on stage and the importance of recognizing labor, particularly on stage and audience witnessed labor, as a part of our working and theatrical worlds. Through butterfly kisses and the materiality of mascara, which was amazing, Jessa has reminded us of the invisible but physical and emotional labors that linger within the material traces in performance art. Nor would I argue that offstage labor can't be made to be seen as beautiful when mediated by and interpreted through an art like photography. Kristen Essen writes of the potentials of photography to make beautiful both the labor of the lighting technicians at her college and the labors of the 1930s in her Theater Topics article, The Aesthetic of Backstage Labor. It's from 2011. This is a correct assessment, and I love this article for asking us as scholars to think differently about offstage labor. But I would also argue that it is not the labor itself that is inherently beautiful, but the mediation through photography that makes it so. What I'm arguing here instead is twofold. One, I am interested in work that tears down the hierarchies that exist between onstage and offstage laborers, as is so wonderfully expressed in the introduction to Working in the Wings, New Perspectives on Theater History and Labor by Elizabeth A. Osborne and Christine Woodworth. But I would argue that an impulse to aestheticize offstage labor automatically reiterates the hierarchy by reinforcing the notion that only labor that can be viewed as art is worthy of equality with onstage or artistic labor. Second, that what an aesthetic offstage labor leaves out is a vital, messy, and quotidian aspect of offstage work, emotional and affective labor. I would argue here that care, when this word means the supporting of another person or persons while repressing, ignoring, or excluding one's own needs, desires, and feelings, is far from aesthetic or artistic, but exists in a place beyond the concepts of art. I will begin with this first point, however, that aestheticizing offstage labor reiterates the notion that in the theater, artistic labor is a labor against which all other labor must be measured. I'd like to tell a recent story from my own experience. It was a lovely interaction, but it has influenced my thinking about how my own offstage work and the work about my own offstage work and the work of other offstage laborers. A few months ago, I was given the assignment of monitoring the men's room line during intermission at a popular musical. This particular theater has its non-accessible restrooms up one flight of stairs, and the restroom line, so that it doesn't interfere with the theater's tiny lobby and its bar and merchandise lines, must snake up the stairs and into the theater's balcony. The other ushers gave me very clear instructions on line control, as this was a very popular show with many male and male identifying patrons. And I was able, thanks to their instructions, to execute the line as it should be executed. A few men complained, as they're wont to do when they have to wait in line for the bathroom. But one man in particular stopped me and said, "That was great direction and choreography." I laughed and I thanked him. It was meant as a compliment and I took it as one. But I began to ask myself, must my labor be equated with onstage work in order to be considered well done and therefore valuable? There is, of course, a further complication between commercial, not-for-profit, and regional theaters and the established hierarchies of theater labor. That is, of course, pay scale and the role of monetary remuneration in determining labor hierarchies. This is interesting on the level of who in the theater has a second house and who in the theater has a second job, as this asks questions about the effects of capitalism on self-worth and worth in the eyes of others. I would be remiss not to mention this, but that is an entire paper on its own, and I'm looking more to a movement that continues academically to acknowledge prejudices in our own studies of theatrical labor and to an opening up of deeper conversations about care and emotional and affective labors as performed by offstage workers. Because anyone who seeks to aestheticize cleaning up vomit has never done it before. Such work is care. I am purposely using the word care because there's an emotional aspect to even this kind of labor, especially if the sick person is elderly or a small child, or even, and in a different way, drunk or somehow otherwise incapacitated. The work of porters who maintain the theater building during the performance and the cleaning people who maintain the front of house and back of house before and after the performance reiterate the importance of this kind of care, which is so often rendered invisible by the concerns and needs of the performance, the artistic labor itself. Backstage workers may well notice their garbage cans are empty, but the audience is often little concerned with this labor unless something is wrong. And this definition of wrong is as multivalent as the word audience. And it is when something goes wrong, whether backstage or in the front of house, that emotional labor, the managing of feelings and reactions may kick in. We can imagine, and perhaps many of us have heard, the calm, collected voice of the stage manager over the god mic, calling a halt to a performance for technical difficulties, or for once in my experience, because a fist fight broke out in the audience. In the front of house, we've been taught a metaphor for these moments. Think of a swan, a bird who glides gracefully over the water while her little feet paddle furiously underneath. I would also apply this metaphor to emotional labor with its surface calm and frantic movement below. When sociologist Arlie Russell Hochschild began to explore emotional labor in the workplace, initially by studying flight attendants in the 1970s and 1980s, she used the concept of acting as a metaphor for the psychological process of repressing one's actual emotions in order to project emotions expected by the other person in a real life or non-theatrical interaction. In this case, the other person is an airline passenger. This repression occurs in public during the interaction, but it may also carry over into the private life of the person as well, who continues to feel the need to control or manage bad reactions to others. Hochschild and other sociologists and labor scholars have followed her have also emphasized how much of this emotional labor is done by women. In my experience in this theater, I would also add persons of color and members of the LGBTQ+ community. When scholars have applied concepts of emotional labor to the theater, they have, in these very few instances, taken the cue from Hochschild and applied emotional labor back to actors. Of course, musing on emotional management as performed by actors goes back to at least the 18th century and Denis Diderot's The Paradox of the Actor, which asks how an actor can seem to suffer emotion on stage but remain unmoved herself. One of the very few contemporary studies of emotional labor in theater is Privileged Emotion Managers, The Case of Actors by David Orchez-Oswitz in the June 2008 issue of Social Psychology Quarterly, in which the author analyzes actors in a repertory company and at three universities, as well as directors and acting teachers, in order to dissect and understand their emotional management techniques. No such study has yet looked at offstage workers. Lauren Switsky in the Spring 2015 Canadian Theatre Review turns the conversation from emotional labor to questions of affective labor, the actor and the audience, and in his article, Marathon Performance, that of Nature Theatre of Oklahoma's Life and Times, for example. Affective labor, a close cousin of emotional labor, is the labor produced to change the emotional experiences of others. What might be flippantly and dismissively called customer service when applied to the front of house, but what should just be called care when applied to either side of the curtain. A truth of affective labor is that it is so often closely paired with unacknowledged emotional labor, whether by performers or audience, or in this paper by offstage laborers. The notion that we workers on a theatrical production are a family often comes from stage management, company management, and house management. But as with family, emotional repression, giving in and covering things over or smoothing them out without solving the internal problems occur. Sometimes, as with family, the pressure is to please rather than to satisfy oneself or be happy. To put others always first, like the stereotype of mother, the ultimate emotional laborer from the past, is to sacrifice oneself to care, and often without acknowledgement. I have one final concern for the continued scholarship of emotional and effective offstage labor, that of the long-running show. While some aesthetic or onstage laborers, particularly musicians, may remain with a show for 3 or 5 or 10 years, this is the so-called golden handcuffs. In my experience, it has been much more likely for an offstage laborer to work the entire duration of a long run. What toll does this unique theatrical experience, that of years of steady work in an industry not necessarily built on that model, what does it take on a laborer who lacks an aesthetic intervention within the work? Now, I know at times this paper may have felt anecdotal and that it speaks in generalizations. And to that, I can only say that the published research that would fuel my paper does not exist. There is a model for contemporary union scholarship in former musicians union business agent Catherine P. Mulder's Unions and Class Transformation, The Case of the Broadway Musicians, published by Routledge in 2009, and in Timothy R. White's Blue Collar Broadway, The Craft and Industry of American Theater, published in 2014. But there is not yet a robust body of academic writing on contemporary theatrical unions and practices. There is, however, an intensified interest in labor studies in the theater in 21st century academia, which is exciting and hopeful. Considering contemporary questions of commercial, not-for-profit, and regional theaters can feel sticky or uncomfortable, as theatrical institutions in the United States, including unions, can also be intertwined with some disconcerting networks of money, privilege, whiteness, and power. But the fact that the theater business is problematic does not change that actual workers who are emotionally and physically involved in their labor are actually performing this offstage work every single day all over the country, or that they were until the pandemic. I'd like to end this paper on this positive note, that offstage laborers in New York and all across Canada and the United States have stepped up to lend emotional, affective, and physical labor to one another and to health and medical professionals in this time of need. Wardrobe unions in particular, and regional costume shops, seamstresses, and freelance wardrobe workers have been sewing masks and gowns for doctors and nurses in need in their local areas, and posting instructive mask making videos on YouTube and do-it-yourself mask PDFs online. Larger union bodies like IATSE have encouraged younger members to connect with their older brothers and sisters who may need assistance in obtaining groceries, accomplishing outdoor tasks, or may merely lack means of communication with others outside their home. This is a moment in which offstage workers are actively demonstrating on a larger scale and outside of their profession that they are well aware of their deep and daily connection to care. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. That was so wonderful. As Christine knows, and some of you know, I am a costume designer also, and I teach costume design and technology at Hunter College. And this mask making process has been such a present activity for costume designers and costume technicians in the past 1 month in the US. Especially after we realized how lacking the essential workers were in personal protective equipment, and that we had the necessary skills to create masks. So it's actually been a privilege to be able to make some masks or provide material for the masks and distribute it to essential workers now. I wanted to start with, I'm seeing if there's any questions online right now. I don't see any questions. So there's so many interesting connections between both of your work. There is a HowlRound question here. Caroline writes, Christine, I'd love to learn more about your paper and your work. I work on these unions and their practices. So that's great. Maybe Christine, you can connect with her.
I'm going to put my email address here, and please contact me. I'd love to speak with you or email with you.
And then actually on the topic of masks, right now, a lot of the unions are also encouraging, some of the Broadway shops have been working on mask making, Broadway costume shops have been working on mask making. So that's really exciting. So Jessa, you mentioned the issue of time and how long it takes Anthony to work on this butterfly kisses, work. And then Christine, I felt like your paper was also discussing the issue of time. Because there's a finite amount of time that the performers, designers, musicians are on stage, while all the theatrical essential workers, ticket takers, cleaners, janitors, ushers, all of them are working at a different time. So I was wondering if both of you wanted to sort of talk a little bit about the sort of added expectation of time when you consider the work of artists who are doing this work. And in Anthony's case, Jessa, this is an aestheticized process, as I understand. So I would love for you guys to talk a little bit more about this issue of time. Christine, you want to go first? Sorry, I just picked Christine, so maybe Christine go first and then Jessa.
Yeah, Christine, go.
Okay, great, thank you, sure. Yes, it's fascinating to me to think about how long a theater is open. Theaters typically open at 7:30 or 8 o'clock in the morning with the doormen and the cleaning people who arrive. The cleaning people arrive to clean the theater from the day before and to clean the dressing rooms. The box office usually arrives around 10. So the theater is an active building the entire day. Usually the front of house staff, the porters again will come earlier, the porters as the cleaning folk. The front of house staff usually has to be there about an hour and a half before. And then as we all know, traditionally actors are there at half hour. That's the traditional, so half an hour before the show starts. I happen to be married to a musician and their local here in New York is called Local 802. And their joke is always, that's when they have to be in the theater. There's actually no requirement for when, as long as they're there by downbeat, as they say, then you're okay. So like this whole idea, and then when the show closes, when it's over, everyone else sort of goes home, but then there are folks like the door people who are there and have to remain there until everyone has left the building. They're the last persons to leave. The thinking about the security guards and about canine, sort of the canine folk now. New York is a different place. You know, many of the theaters have metal detectors now. So there's all these different layers of these folks who come in and out and have different duties and who are keeping the theater functioning in all of these different timeframes and who can leave when and where. The security guards have to stay till all of the actors leave because they're there to provide security when the actors are out signing autographs, et cetera. So, I mean, there's just all these flows of folk in and out of the theater, persons that are, you know, here then, gone then. It's really fascinating. It's a really vibrant world that is so much more than, you know, the 2.5 hours of the performance.
Yeah, and just going off that, I think that one of time is absolutely a really important aspect in Butterfly Kisses, but I think a big aspect is that Antoni has complete control of her time. She can decide when to start the performance each day. She can decide the amount of time she needs to rest before starting the next interval. And I mean, just from, you know, doing it for one day, I found that it, because she broke it, you break it up into three parts, it does take up a lot of your day, because 20 butterfly kisses might not seem like a lot, but again, it's, you do the butterfly kiss, which takes a couple seconds, and then you reapply mascara. And so the amount of time it took to actually do one interval was much more extensive than I had expected. And so for me, the aspect of time now after doing this experience is definitely something that I want to explore more in terms of butterfly kisses, because I do really think that it's a really important element and it affects the artist's ability to engage in the performance and endure the labor.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jessa. And I think both of you are talking about one thing that's like, what is personal time versus what is collective time? And how personal time is up to you, but versus collective time within a theater setting is sort of, you can't really encroach, you know, you have to sort of, it's defined. It's very, very strictly defined. So we have a question here and it sort of relates to the work, to one of my questions. So I will open that up. We have a question on from Srabosti Ghosh, and she writes, how does the performativity of offstage labor affect spectators? And what about the gender role in equality in offstage labor? Maybe Jessa and then Christine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I think that in terms of butterfly kisses, it is a private performance. Nobody did actually see it. It's hard to, the performativity kind of exists in each spectator's understanding of the work. And so I think that in terms of Antoni's work, she did it for many months, and activities repeated over many months increases this sort of the relevance that they have to the viewer, at least from my understanding. And I think that to me is a way that she accesses the performative of offstage labor when in fact we weren't able to see it. And the performative is kind of hidden in the traces.
Hello, guest. Yes, excellent. I think the gender question is really fascinating to me. There would have to be really some deep talk about some union membership and some ideas, especially in the Broadway and commercial theater, and what areas have traditionally been open to women, to gay men, and to other of the LGBTQ plus community, and what has been open to straight white men, and what kind of jobs. I can say, like, speaking from the front of house, I was the very first female door person that my company ever hired. So door people, I mean, for a long time, they were men. That was just how it was. For a long time, ticket takers were paid more money than ushers were paid, including the head usher, who is technically their boss. And that was a gendered thing. A lot of times, almost entirely, ticket takers were men and women were ushers. So it's really interesting to think about those things. And then the areas particularly where women have really been able to break in. Now, traditionally, women were involved in wardrobe, but there are so many women stage managers, like stage managers, for example, yes. And it's interesting to me that those are two roles that I really associate with care and with emotional and affective labor. Also sound board operators, a lot of women in soundboard operation. And some of that is because that is a skill. That is something that you have to learn and you have to be excellent at. And so I do know a lot of women soundboard operators. But it really does, it really is a great question to ask about that gendering of roles. And then I forget, there's something about performativity, yes? Of offstage labor. It's interesting. Sometimes the performativity of offstage labor, if you think of like accidentally seeing a stagehand or if a show stops and someone has to come on and fix a set, it's always kind of one of my favorite things, because it sort of changes our life in the house, is one thing. But I can also say as a front of house person, you can imagine that in the world of cell phone technology and sometimes people behaving in different ways inside the theater, we are pressured both to stop behavior and then also not to get in the way of the show. So that would be ways that we have to perform as a part of our job to sort of, you know, stop videoing, for example, or whatever those things might be if somebody is being particularly disruptive. I have worked on a Disney show and people do sometimes think that this is a sing-along for their child. And so that can be a problematic too, and that the performativity of the audience is actually causing us as offstage laborers to have to perform in a way that we'd much prefer not to because other audience members are irritated or what have you.
Thank you, Christine. That's great. We have another question for you, and this is specifically about union regulations from Curtis. Do you foresee any potential union regulations or cultures that might impede further research?
I don't think regulations. There's no like code of silence that, you know, whatever that might be. But cultures, most certainly. The reason I'm not writing my dissertation on this topic is very much to do with that. I am still a union member. I'm still employed. Well, hopefully one day I'll be employed again in the theater. And I don't want to write about this. I'm not comfortable writing about this in as like a dissertation topic as long as I'm employed. Because one, I mean, I'm a member of the union. I feel that I am a union member and that is something I should respect. But I would say that there can be cultures. I think it's not surprising that the book that I talked about the Broadway musicians, that she wrote it after she stopped working for the union. So she wrote it with her past knowledge, because I think that's just, I think that's proper. I think that's, you have to look with hindsight, not while you're in it, not while you're a part of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know that in the costume designers union, there's a big issue with not costume designers themselves, but costume technicians, but also in the nonprofit sector, costume technicians and designers are paid so little that now there's a movement called Costumers for Wage Equity, who are really trying to, because the scenic design fees are not usually at par with costume design fees. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it sort of like trickles down, then costume technicians get lesser amounts, mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. So,
and that could really turn back to the gender question again.
Absolutely, absolutely.
100%.
And wardrobe costumes tends to be a female LGBTQ friendly space. So, you mm-hmm. know, very, very easy to become invisible in those spaces. Mm-hmm. Jessa, I am going, you made one point that we're at 3:13. So maybe we'll have one more question and we can sort of wrap up. So there's a question here. I'll come back to my question if you have time. From Sandeepan, there's a question: what is the role of the theater director in offstage labor? Christine and Jessa?
The theater director in offstage labor. Well, I don't consider the director in offstage labor because of the way that I'm looking at artistic creation and about having agency and choice in the final artistic project. So to me, the director leaves her mark, and often if a show runs for a period of time, she comes back multiple times. So to me, I feel that what gets interesting is when you consider the stage manager who maintains the director's vision, that becomes a whole other interesting question that would actually be really fun to explore, but we don't have a lot of time. To say that, yes, the director, I feel, has that agency and choice, and so is not the offstage laborer that I'm interested in.
Jessa, do you want to add to that? In your case, it seems like Anthony is working both as an artist and a director.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I mean, I would say that all artists are a director in some sense because they do have that their own creative license. But the parallel that I can connect to that is would be the role of a curator. And what happens once Anthony's work is put into a gallery or a museum? And in terms of what I understand from Antoni is that because a lot of her performances are material trace, and she uses real life materials, she's used soap and chocolate and hair dye. A lot of times if her work becomes part of a collection, there is this deterioration rate that mm-hmm. becomes part of the performance once in the gallery. And for the curator, from what I've understood in my reading, is that that becomes a problem. And the curators want to stop her work from deteriorating or changing. For example, her soap sculptures, they change over time. And that's become a really big issue for her work being on display. But to Antoni, the endurability of her materials becomes, again, part of her performance. And she really advocates for what happens once the work is not in her hands anymore and is in the hands of the curator and in the gallery space. And so I would say that in terms of her material trace performances, she definitely wants her work to be shown and on display, but at the end of the day, like I said, a lot of times artists are the director as much as they are the artist, and they're really passionate about where they want their work to go. Speaking as an artist myself, this is how I feel. And so, yeah, I definitely think that the role of the curator is an important and integral aspect. But within Tony, she's more concerned with the honesty and integrity of what she wants her work to be.
Absolutely. Thank you, Jessa. That is really, really great to know. We have one more question. And Mayu, I think we are at time now. We have one more question, and then I wanted to sort of wrap up with the with this issue of something you discussed, Jessa, which was familiarity with the process. In Anthony's case, people who, audience members who have familiarity of putting on makeup have a better ability to gauge that work. And many of us working in theater settings within the academia try to give our students this experience of familiarity of different areas of theater, whether it's backstage work, ushering, cleaning up after strikes, restocking costumes, restocking, breaking down scenery, all of these aspects, first building the scenery and then breaking down the scenery so that they have this experience of putting everything together and then wrapping it up. And Lin-Manuel Miranda famously said, I think after his successful Hamilton creation, he said that because he had familiarity with every aspect of theater, he felt like his work was, he had a better grasp of theater making because of that. So that's sort of, I just wanted to raise that within how in the training process within academic settings, we try to make sure that there is this equality in the theatrical experience. And then maybe we can finish with Ru Xiao's question, which is how are technologies, especially new technical availabilities on and off stage, changing the presentation and aestheticization of both the product and process of invisible and offstage labor? Thank you. And then Jessa, you want to go first or Christine? Sorry.
I guess I can go. You know, technological advances, I mean, pretty much since the ancient Greeks have affected offstage labor. When you think about, you know, the deus ex machina, you know, coming out, somebody had to be back there, you know, moving that lever, right? So it's a really interesting question. You know, when the musicians went on strike in 2005, there was the whole question of, are we going to be replacing musicians with virtual orchestras? You know, will we just plug in a tape and play them? And I mean, people died when the microphone got introduced. It seems to me that often technology doesn't make the labor any more visible, or maybe a little bit more invisible, in that once upon a time, a guy with a rope and a pulley was pulling the set down. Now all those dudes sit downstairs at a little desk with their TV, and they're bored, and they this is automation, basically, you know, press buttons. And I've talked to lots of automation guys, and the job is very serious because they control machinery that can actually kill people. So they take their jobs very seriously. But it is different. Something that maybe used to require seven guys with pulleys now is one guy pushing a button or two guys pushing a button or buttons to make effects work. So at times I think technology both eliminates and makes labor invisible, and in that you don't think about the guy that's down there while, you know, the stage is rotating, right? But also you weren't really looking at the guy who was on the treadmill either when you're looking at like the Torelli system, right? Where there were guys down there, you know, shirtless, sweating. So I don't know that it renders it any more invisible, but it has definitely changed the kind of labor and the ways in which that labor is invisible, but still invisible, I think.
Yeah. Jessa?
Technology and material trace performance in terms of butterfly kisses, is not something that I've ever really thought that too much about, just because in my own separations of types of performance art, I've seen this type of performance as one that is rooted in the creation of an object. So specifically a painting, a sculpture, a print, a drawing. Whereas I've looked at photo documented performance, which obviously utilizes a type of technology as a separate form. And so for me, I would say that if, you know, technology, depending on what, you know, you mean by technology, but my first thought when it comes to this would be a camera or something else, right? And or a video camera. And so in that lens, I think that had Antoni utilized technology, her labor would be more visible, right? Just from my own documentation, when I documented me doing that one session, I think it's a bit more clear of the labor and my actions and what I did during, like how close I actually got to the paper, each, you know, the steps that I had to take. And so, of course, depending on what type of technology we're referring to, I would say that there is the possibility for it to make labor more visible, especially in a work like Butterfly Kisses, which at the end of the day is quite ambiguous and abstract.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much, Jessa. I think it's time for us to wrap up. So I want to finish with a quick applause for both of our speakers, and then we can open up the space for our next panel. Thank you so much.
And
Thank you.
Stay well and be safe.
You too.
Thank you. You too.
Bye. Yes.